Meine sehr geehrten Damen und Herren, sehr geehrte Frau Professor Samuelson, sehr geehrte Frau Professor Ammar, ich freue mich sehr, dass ich Sie heute Abend in der Blumenthal-Akademie des Jüdischen Museums Berlin begrüßen darf. Mein Name ist Sophia Novak und ich bin wissenschaftliche Mitarbeiterin des Jüdisch-Islamischen Forums unserer Akademieprogramme. Der heutige Abend ist der letzte Abend der zweiten Staffel unserer Ringvorlesung, die in diesem Jahr den ethischen Fragen in Judentum und Islam gewidmet war. Sie wurde vom Jüdisch-Islamischen Forum der Akademieprogramme organisiert. Gefördert wurde die Reihe durch die Allianz Kulturstiftung, der ich hier meinen sehr herzlichen Dank aussprechen möchte. In den bisherigen Veranstaltungen unserer Reihe haben wir unter anderem nach jüdischen und muslimischen Vorstellungen über eine gerechte Sozial- und Wirtschaftsethik gefragt. Wir haben über die Grenzen des menschlichen Lebens, über legitime Gewaltanwendung im Kriegsfall und über Sexualmoral diskutiert. Heute werden wir uns dem Thema Umweltethik widmen. Ich freue mich sehr, dass wir für den heutigen Abend Herrn Dr. Martin Mahmud Kellner als Moderator gewinnen konnten. Dr. Kellner hat Kultur- und Sozialanthropologie in Kombination mit den Fächern Arabistik, Turkologie, Psychologie, Soziologie und Musikwissenschaften in Wien studiert. Danach begann er in Damaskus das Studium der islamischen Wissenschaften in einer sehr angesehenen Hochschule des Islams, der Ma'had al-Fatr. Dort studierte er über 10 Jahre Arabisch, Koran und Hadith-Wissenschaften, islamisches Recht, Rechtsmethodologie und Glaubenslehre. Seit 2013 ist er wissenschaftlicher Mitarbeiter am Institut für Islamische Theologie in Osnabrück. Er ist Begründer, Vorstandsvorsitzender und Projektleiter der Bildungsinitiative Madrasa, Verein für islamische Bildung und interkulturellen Dialog. Dieser Verein widmet sich der Vermittlung traditioneller islamischer Wissenschaften in deutscher Sprache sowie der Förderung des interreligiösen Dialogs. Bevor ich das Wort an Herrn Kellner übergebe, möchte ich Sie bereits heute auf die dritte Staffel unserer Ringvorlesung aufmerksam machen. Am 23. November beginnen wir mit einer neuen Reihe, die sich den jüdischen und muslimischen Perspektiven auf die Menschenrechte widmen wird. Ich übergebe das Wort nun an Herrn Kellner. Vielen Dank.
Meine sehr verehrten Damen und Herren, liebe Frau Novak, zunächst einmal vielen Dank für die freundliche Einführung. Es ist für mich eine Freude und Ehre, wieder mal einen Abend, diese Ringvorlesung öffnen zu können. Der heutige Abend steht unter dem Titel Der Mensch als Herr oder Hüter der Schöpfung als Frage. Und ich fand es sehr interessant, dass die sechs Vorträge im Rahmen dieser Ringvorlesung abwechselnd mit Punkt bzw. mit Fragezeichen endeten. Das heißt, die Titel waren an drei Abenden als Frage formuliert. Und das zeigt sehr gut, worum es in diesen Vorlesungen geht. Also insbesondere, wenn man über Ethik spricht, über vergleichende Ethik, gibt es Fragen, die es wert sind, dass sie gestellt werden und die zugleich wichtige intellektuelle, geistige, spirituelle, moralische Fragen öffnen, ohne sie in vielen Fällen auch wirklich abschließen zu können. Und wir haben heute sozusagen diesen Bereich Umweltethik, der Mensch als Schöpfer, der Mensch als Herr oder Hüter der Schöpfung. Und wenn wir heute auf den Zustand unseres Planeten sehen, den Zustand der Menschheit betrachten, den Zustand unserer Umwelt betrachten, dann sehen wir, und ich glaube, das ist Konsens, dass wir in einer Krise sind, in einer relativ tiefen Krise. Wir sprechen über eine Krise des Planeten. In Wirklichkeit ist es eine Krise auch unseres Lebensraums und aus dem Grund ist es eine Krise unserer selbst. Das Interessante ist, es gibt und gab im Laufe der Menschheitsgeschichte zahlreiche Krisen. Aber die Umweltkrise, in der wir uns befinden, ist deshalb so besonders, weil sie jedes Land, jede Kultur und jeden Menschen irgendwann einmal betreffen kann. Das heißt, es ist tatsächlich eine gemeinsame Krise. Und das Wort Krise, wird in der chinesischen Sprache, wie immer wieder gesagt wird, mit einem Schriftzeichen ausgedrückt, das aus zwei Teilen besteht oder aus zwei Wörtern besteht, nämlich aus dem Wort Chance, aus dem Wort Gefahr einerseits und aus dem Wort Chance andererseits. Also jede Krise hat das Potenzial, auch eine Chance zu sein. Gleichzeitig natürlich, und das hört man ja, ist in jeder Krise ein Gefahrenmoment enthalten. Und ich glaube, eine Chance, die wir haben, eine Chance, die sich für die Menschen ergibt und die sich auch ganz besonders hier in diesem Kontext auch für die jüdisch-islamischen Beziehungen ergibt, ist die, dass wir durch eine Krise näher rücken. Menschen, die in einer Gefahrensituation sind, neigen dazu, dass sie sozusagen einander näher kommen, um ein Problem zu lösen. Das ist eine sehr vernünftige Reaktion. Und auch wenn wir über die Krise des Planeten, über die Krise der Umwelt und so weiter sprechen, ist es eine Chance, dass wir einander näher kommen. Aus dem Grund ist auch der Rahmen dieser Ringvorlesung jüdisch und islamische Perspektiven so interessant. Gleichzeitig ist natürlich auch immer eine Gefahr in einer Krise, nämlich eine der vielen Gefahren ist, dass man einander Schuld zuschiebt. Das ist eine Gefahr. Wiederum eine Chance ist die, dass man Verantwortungen erkennt, dass man sich selbst nach Schuld fragt und dass man bewusster wird, dass man sich selbst reflektiert. Und hier sozusagen, und der heutige Abend steht auch im Rahmen einer Selbstreflexion. Es steht in der Ankündigung, dass immer wieder der Vorwurf erhoben wird, dass die abrahamitische Tradition mit Schuld an der ökologischen Krise hat. Und sozusagen unter dieser Reflexion, unter diesem großen Titel steht der heutige Abend. Und es ist auch deshalb interessant, dass man sagt, heute mit Schuld. Vor einigen Jahrzehnten hätte man vielleicht gesagt, die abrahamitischen Traditionen haben ihren Beitrag geleistet, dass der Mensch eine Kultur entwickelt, eine Kultur der Naturbeherrschung entwickelt, dass der Mensch sich weiterentwickelt, dass der Mensch Hochkulturen entwickelt und so weiter. Heute spricht man von einer Schuld. Warum? Weil man weiß, dass nicht alle Entwicklungen, die sozusagen im Rahmen unserer kulturellen Differenzierung vor sich gegangen sind, auch tatsächlich zum Wohl der Menschheit sind. Und wie auch immer, es ist hier eine wichtige anthropologische Frage oder religionsanthropologische Frage ist immer wieder die, ist die Naturbeherrschung eine Frucht der monotheistischen Religionen? Also beherrscht der Mensch die Natur, weil er diesen Auftrag sozusagen aus seiner Religion heraus bekommen hat? Oder aber, das ist ein anderes anthropologisches Paradigma, ist es so, dass die Religion eine Folge der Naturbeherrschung ist? Das ist ein funktionalistisches Religionsverständnis, wo man sagt, also Religionen entwickeln sich aus einer Hochkultur heraus. Das ist etwas, was wir heute nicht lösen können. Wichtig ist, dass wir uns heute damit mit der Frage beschäftigen, in welcher Art und Weise Religionen bestimmte Eingriffe in die Natur, in das Ökosystem legitimieren. Das ist eine wichtige Frage. Und ich würde noch eine Frage, und die steht sozusagen in der Ankündigung dieser Vorlesung, und ich würde noch eine Frage hinzufügen, nämlich inwiefern die Religionen auch das Potenzial haben, Eingriffe in die Natur zu regulieren, sie ethisch tragbar zu machen, sie zu beschränken auf das, was noch dem Wohl der Menschheit dient. Und das ist sozusagen eine kurze Einleitung in das Thema dieses Abends. Und wir haben, wie an allen Abenden bisher in diesem Museum, wieder mal hochqualifizierte Rednerinnen. Und ich habe die Freude, Ihnen die erste Rednerin kurz vorstellen zu dürfen. Frau Hava Tirosh-Samuelson. Ich hoffe, es ist richtig ausgesprochen. Sie hat promoviert im Bereich der jüdischen Philosophie und Mystik. Und nebenbei hat sie auch graduiert im Bereich der Religionswissenschaften. Das heißt, sie hat sozusagen diese beiden Perspektiven zusammengebracht in ihrem Studium. Und sie ist heute Professorin für moderne Judaistik, für jüdische Studien und für Geschichte an der Arizona State University. Zuvor hat sie an vielen anderen renommierten Universitäten unterrichtet und gelehrt, an der Indiana University, an der Columbia University, an Hebrew Union College und so weiter. Die Problematik, wie Sie wissen, ist immer für den Moderator, wenn man hochqualifizierte Wissenschaftler vor sich hat, dass man sich immer reduzieren muss auf einige wenige wichtige Punkte. Und würde ich den ganzen Lebenslauf dieser beiden Rednerinnen vorlesen, dann hätten sie keine Zeit mehr, hier weiter zu sprechen. Aus dem Grund reduziere ich mich darauf. Sie beschäftigt sich in ihren Forschungen hauptsächlich mit mittelalterlicher und frühmoderner jüdischer Geistesgeschichte. Und hier ganz besonders mit der Beziehung zwischen Philosophie und Mystik im Judentum. Und ich möchte zwei wissenschaftliche Publikationen nennen, die in dem Bereich wichtig sind. Einerseits hat sie ein Buch herausgegeben über das Konzept von Glück im vormodernen Judentum. Und das zweite Buch, das sie herausgegeben hat und das für den heutigen Abend so besonders wichtig ist, ist ein Buch über Judentum und Ökologie, die erschaffene und die entdeckte Welt. Und sie beschäftigt sich damit sozusagen mit dem Erbe von ökologischem Denken im Judentum, in der jüdischen Tradition und versucht das zu systematisieren. Und das ist sozusagen die Aufgabe einer modernen Theologie, dass man das, was die Religion sozusagen an Potenzial bietet, in einer für die heutige moderne Welt verfügbar macht, systematisch zusammenfasst. Und wir freuen uns, Frau Professor Samuelson hier begrüßen zu dürfen. Und ja, begrüßen Sie mit einem Applaus.
Good evening. It's an honor to be here in the Berlin Jewish Museum. My husband and I spend the morning there, and it was an overwhelming experience. I'm sure you can all appreciate when I say that I was very moved and, of course, very saddened by being there. It's also very thrilling for me to be in Germany, in Berlin, and experience the revival of Jewish life here in Germany, even though we also know that there is the rise, the resurgence of anti-Semitism, even today here in Germany and perhaps all over Europe. But I think it's very appropriate for the museum to create this lecture series in which we bring together Judaism and Islam and hopefully other religious communities in Germany. So I fully agree with the introduction when you said that the ecological crisis can really bring us all together because we have a crisis that is threatening life on Earth. So our ecological crisis is real, it is planetary in scope, it is multifaceted, it's multifactorial, and it's anthropogenic, namely it's generated by human activities. It is indisputable that we now witness large-scale environmental degradation as a result of actions that were taken already in the middle of the 18th century, but of course primarily through the 19th century and the 20th century. And we now have a situation in which we created, at least in the United States, when we say it, it's not obvious that what I'm going to say right now, but I'm going to tell you that we have created the ecological crisis. As E.O. Wilson, the very important biologist, said, by using the atmosphere as the carbon dump of the Industrial Revolution and pressing on without caution, humanity has raised the concentration of greenhouse gases, primarily carbon dioxide and methane, to a dangerous level, end quote. So greenhouse gases trapped in the atmosphere have brought about global warming, as a result of which we now experience changes in rain precipitation, in rising sea levels, in retreating of glaciers, decreasing of extent and thinness of Arctic ice, changes in bird migration patterns, and in the length of growing seasons. All over the world, people experience extreme weather events as a result of global warming. We have heat waves. I'm from Arizona. We definitely experience in Arizona. Heat waves, we have heavy downpours. We have higher, strong intensity of downpour. We have frequent floods. We have longer droughts. We have frequent and intense wildfires. At the same time, we also have soil moisture deficits, water-related pest outbreaks, and species extinction. The loss of biodiversity is a very important feature of our ecological crisis. Many species are dying off or risking extinction because of the loss of their habitats as a result of climate change, as well as destructive human practices, especially industrial agriculture, deforestation, large-scale hunting, overuse of resources, and pollution of water, air, and soil. Underlying all of these problems, of course, we have the rise in human population. So the growth of human population contributes to the proliferation of destitution and misery and increase of poverty. In short, our planet is ill and it requires healing. And that could come only if we change our moral reasoning concerning our relationship to the living environment. Judaism, along with other world religions, offers such a shift in moral reasoning. Precisely because the environmental crisis was brought about by human actions, human beings have a moral responsibility to address the challenge. The title of the event tonight, Man as Lord or Guardian of Creation, captures what we find why we find ourselves in this crisis and how we can seek to address the crisis. The title, of course, to everybody who knows the Bible, the title, of course, echoes the two creation narratives in the Bible. According to the first narrative, God has commanded humanity, quote, to be fertile and increase, fill the earth and master it, unquote. That's Genesis chapter 1, verse 28. Whereas according to the second narrative, God has placed the human in the Garden of Eden, quote, to till and protect it. The two biblical narratives signal paradigmatic human attitudes toward the natural world. The first connotes dominion, mastery, and control of nature, whereas the second signifies caring, concern, and stewardship. In 1967, Lynn White Jr., the medieval historian, created a major public storm when he published a short essay in the magazine Science, in which he placed the responsibility for the ecological crisis on the Judeo-Christian tradition, especially the Bible. Referencing only the first creation narrative, Lynn White claimed that the Bible articulated a worldview that privileges humanity over all other beings, giving humans a license to exploit natural resources for their sole benefit. As Jewish and Christian biblical scholars, theologians, philosophers, and historians rose to respond to White's concerns or accusations, they began to examine the sacred text of their traditions in light of the ecological crisis, giving rise to a new academic field, or we can call it discourse, that goes by various names, either eco-theology, religion and ecology, or religious environmentalism. So being environmentally aware and concerned, religious scholars have begun to recover, reinterpret, and reconstruct their respective traditions, showing that they have articulated positive paradigms of human interaction with the natural world. Due to their interpretive work, it has become clear that world religions are crucial to our attempt to address all aspects of the ecological crisis, because religions articulate moral values, ethical ideals, legal norms, and daily rituals that frame human interaction with nature. Religion, and I would try to say all religions, all world religions, move people to action. So there's no way to talk about the ecological crisis without religion. This evening, I will present the main principles of Jewish environmental ethics, which can be summarized by one word: responsibility. Jewish environmental ethics of responsibility is inherently religious, arising from the covenantal relationship between God and humanity. It is law-governed, revolving around the notion of duty to observe divine commands rather than the inherent rights of natural objects. And it posits a close connection between moral well-being and environmental well-being, between social justice and environmental justice. Jewish environmental ethics of responsibility was articulated first in the Bible. It reflects the agrarian life of ancient Israel in the land of Israel, where the danger of desertification was, and still is, I should say, a daily reality. While my comments this evening will highlight the Bible, I ask you to remember that the Bible is but the foundational document of Judaism, and that the Judaic tradition has continued to evolve beyond the Bible through the process of interpretation carried out by theologians, philosophers, and mystics. Without doing justice to the richness of the Judaic tradition, I will argue that the principle of Judaic environmental ethics can serve as inspiration for sound environmental policies. This is not to say that for each and every environmental problem or disputed issue, there is a relevant Judaic proof text. but rather that the Judaic environmental ethics of responsibility can help us frame the discussion. I'm now moving to give you the principles of Judaic normative environmental ethics. So Jewish environmental ethics is rooted in two main religious beliefs. First, that God created the world. And second, that God revealed his will in the form of law, the Torah. The belief in creation states that the world was brought into existence by God, the creator. As creator, God is the sole and rightful owner of the world. God is the sole and rightful owner of the world. That means that the world does not belong to human beings, but to God, the creator. The act of creation culminated in the creation of the human earthling. In Hebrew, we call it Adam. And Adam, the first earthling, was created in the image of God. In Hebrew, we say Tzelem Elohim. Being created by God, the human being is part of nature and has much in common with all other creatures in the physical world. Indeed, the human earthling belongs to the earth. In Hebrew, the word earth is Adama, and you can hear Adam and Adama are obviously linguistically connected words. So the human being belongs to the earth, Adama, to which the human returns at death. The human earthling is undoubtedly dependent on the earth, but the human is also endowed with the capacity to transcend earthly life, precisely because the human was created in the image of God. The precise meaning of creation in the image of God has been given many interpretations, but all of them presuppose that human beings have the capacity to imitate God in some way, to enter a relationship with God, and to be able to receive divine commands through revelation. So revelation is the second foundational belief of Judaism. According to this belief, God entered a special relationship, namely a covenant, in Hebrew brit, with the people of Israel. The covenant is everlasting and is law-centered. God revealed his will to Israel in the form of law, the Torah, and Israel is obligated to follow the Torah. In return to observance of the Torah, or observance of the law, God will reward Israel in this world and in the world to come, or in the afterlife. The divinely revealed law instructs human how to act in the right way toward the created world and toward each other. What's unique here is that the brit, the covenant between God and Israel, has a collateral, and that collateral is the land of Israel. The land functioned like a litmus test to the quality of the relationship between God and the people of Israel. When Israel observes God's will, the land flourishes, and all the material needs of its inhabitants are satisfied. But when Israel ignores divine expectations and follows other gods, the land loses its fertility and becomes uninhabitable. The fecundity of the land is thus the marker of the quality of the covenantal relationship and the moral integrity of the people of Israel. So covenantal relationship is grounded in the value of responsibility. And by this I mean two things. Humanity is responsible to God by being responsible for the well-being of the world that God has created. The Judaic ethics of responsibility frames the attitude toward the natural world in terms of duties. Humans are obligated to behave in a certain way toward the natural world and to be accountable for their actions. The divine commandments, in Hebrew we call it mitzvot, specify how to treat the natural world, how to treat the soil, how to treat vegetation, how to treat animals, and explain why human well-being is so dependent on the well-being of the natural environment. So the underlying assumption of this environmental legislation is that God is the true proprietor of the earth. Leviticus 25, verse 23 says that when the laws of the sabbatical year were promulgated, God asserted, quote, that the land is mine, an assertion that is restated poetically in the Psalms, in Psalm 24:1. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. The rabbis use this verse to justify the ruling, quote, that man may not taste anything until he has recited the blessing, so that anyone who derives benefit from this world without a blessing is guilty of misappropriating sacred property. Since the creator is the true owner of the earth, humans are viewed as but temporary tenants of the land. They are to care for the earth rather than to exploit it for their own needs. So the Bible recognizes the creative tension between the human capacity to control. The Bible doesn't ignore it. It recognizes that humans have the capacity to control the natural world. And they, on the other hand, humans also have responsibility to take care of the natural world. And these two postures should not be seen as contradictory. It's not either or. Rather, they should be seen as complementary capacities. Human beings have the capacity, the creative ability, to make it possible to benefit from nature. And they can also transform the world of nature. Therefore, the Jewish tradition regards the human being as a partner of God, a moral agent who is accountable to God as part of the covenantal relationship with God. The Judaic tradition is also aware that the human creative capacity can be destructive. To mitigate that innate destructive capacity, the second creation narrative therefore tells us that our job is to guard and protect the natural world and to ensure it that we will not destroy, that the world will not be destroyed by human actions. When the two creation narratives are read in tandem as complementary, it becomes clear that the Bible limits human action in regard to nature. First, humans must act in accordance with divine commands that specify how to treat the natural environment. Second, human actions are to be undertaken for the sake of improving the created world. The created world is good, but it's not perfect and can be ameliorated through constructive engagement with nature. And third, humans must regularly cease their creative activities by resting on the Sabbath, imitating God who rested on the seventh day of creation. So I would say that the Sabbath is one of the most important ecological principles in Judaism. By acting responsibly toward the earth and its inhabitants, humanity functions as a caretaker or a steward of creation, increasing order in the created world and protecting against destruction. Now I'm going to go through several principles and give you specific examples how Judaism tells us what to do vis-a-vis the soil, vegetation, animals, and so forth. Let's talk about the soil first. Judaism has very extensive land ethics. There are many commandments that pertain to the soil, to plant, and to food production. Since God is viewed as the rightful owner of the land of Israel, the Israelites are only tenant farmers, as I said, and they are obligated to give the first portion of everything the land produces back to God. That principle was elaborated by the rabbis in the Mishnah, but basically it's very simple. Whatever the land produces first, you have to give it as a gift back to God. It's a beautiful principle, and of course in ancient Israel they were able to observe that principle. Specifically about trees, trees are singled out for special attention. Leviticus tells us that, for example, during the first 3 years of growth, the fruits of newly planted trees or vineyards are not to be eaten because they are considered God's property. So if we think about everything that we produce as something that belongs to God first, I think we can do quite well, environmentally speaking. Now, whereas ancient Israelite society was an agrarian society, for most of its history, Jews did not live in the land of Israel. They lived throughout the diaspora, and they lived in urban communities. They derived their livelihood from commerce and trade rather than agriculture. This urban life has created a certain distancing between Jews and the natural world, but modern Zionism has tried to reverse it and brought back the Jewish people to the ancestral homeland and used agriculture as a way to recover Jewish life and to revive all aspects of being Jewish in the modern world. Now, interestingly enough, in the modern state of Israel, agriculture has had remarkable success. And there are many new technological innovations. But also, I should tell you that today agriculture accounts for a very small percentage of Israel's GDP. While most agricultural accomplishments in Israel have been carried out with no appeal to Jewish law, Some Israelis, actually, Israeli environmentalists, actually are trying to do their agricultural activity in light of scriptural legislation. So we have an attempt right now in Israel to return back to biblical environmentalism, if you wish, and to combine environmental concerns with some of the insights of the ancient way of doing agriculture. You can look at what's going on in environmentalism today in Israel as a kind of a critique of contemporary agricultural practices, especially of techno-capitalist consumer culture, practices that have only deteriorated the quality of the soil and increased human vulnerability. So both in Israel and in the United States, there are some Orthodox Jews that are really trying to combine scripturally based farming and contemporary kind of critique of what's going on in techno-capitalist consumer culture. So this is just one example. Let me talk a little bit about protection of biodiversity. The Bible makes it very clear that God created the world and divided it according to kinds, namely recognize the diversity here, and the Bible speaks very clearly against mixing, either mixing of animals or mixing of plants or mixing of anything. So the idea of keeping the diversity as it was created is a very, very important principle. The rabbis also recognize that principle, and what we have here is an attempt to think Jewishly about preservation of species and ecosystems. And the recognition is that we need diversity for the ecosystem to work. Now let's take it and speak a little bit about diversity in light, or biodiversity in light of some contemporary technological things. What are we going to do today in terms of genetic engineering, for example? There are a lot of contemporary technologies that clearly modify the genetic makeup of organisms. So do they violate the Jewish prohibitions on grafting of plants and crossbreedings? Well, this is kind of complicated issue. Some ethicists, including people who were teaching here in the Berlin Jewish Museum, I refer to Lori Zoloff. She, for example, argues that Judaism is remarkably open to genetically modified technologies, on the ground that what is not listed in the Jewish text is forbidden. If it's not listed as forbidden, then it's permitted. I don't know if everybody would agree with her interpretation, but the bottom line is that she allows for that kind of genetically modified organism to be. I'm less sympathetic to genetically modified organism than maybe she is, but my point is that you can use Jewish environmental legislation and talk about genetic modified organism and come to think about it, which is a very contemporary issue. In terms of food production, here the Jewish tradition clearly puts lots of limits, I would say severe limits on food consumption, especially consumption of animals. And the Jewish tradition regulates all sorts of food. That's what we call the kashrut system, the kosher system. I'm sure people are familiar with it. Really distinguishes between clean and unclean animals. And I think that this in and of itself puts already an incredible limit on what we can and cannot eat. So environmentally, the kashrut system is a very positive system. I should also tell you that many people who are environmentally concerned, many Jewish people are environmentally concerned, think that vegetarianism is the way to go. And that's really the moral idea and more ideal that we should follow. And personally, I feel that they are absolutely correct. So the kashrut system also is environmentally a very useful one. Let's talk a little bit about future generation. Judaism is very concerned for the future of life after each one of us dies. Life goes on, and we need to be sure that we maintain future generations. So the rabbis developed that ideas, and I would like to suggest to you that you don't just have to go to Jewish rabbinic sources. You can look at Jewish thinkers in the 20th century who were not necessarily observant Jews, but who had a lot to say about the principle of responsibility. And I'm referring to Hans Jonas. Hans Jonas was a German Jew, a very important Jewish philosopher. And Hans Jonas really made a superb analysis of the concept of responsibility and basically told us, and I'll get to the chase of it, he basically told us that we have a priori responsibility to the future. A priori responsibility to the future, which means that we have to make sure that the world will exist and that humanity will exist, that life will exist. That's our responsibility. And it's very much, he suggested in his analysis, it's very similar to the responsibility that parents have toward their children. And that parental care is always future-oriented. We need to think about the future, never just about the present. In that, with that in mind, let me introduce you to another Jewish idea, the idea of prohibiting and preventing wanton destruction. In Hebrew, that's known as the principle of bal tashchit, of do not destroy. Basically, there is a prohibition on wanton destruction. And everybody who lives today knows how much there is wanton destruction. And the Jewish tradition, the rabbis especially, took that principle and really elaborated that principle and explained it in very detailed way, how to avoid unnecessary destruction. So think about it and realize how environmentally useful that idea is. Let's talk specifically about animals. The Jewish tradition makes it very clear that you need to prevent the distress of living being or living creatures. We call it in Hebrew, tsa'ar ba'alei chaim. There is clearly an obligation of causing unnecessary pain to animals. And that, of course, brings the question of food that we slaughter in order to eat. So aren't we causing a lot of distress to those animals? And here, the Jewish tradition tries to minimize it by specifying how to kill animals very, very quickly and very swiftly and with minimum pain. But again, I would suggest that ideally Judaism is for vegetarianism rather than for animal. Why should we avoid hurting animals? The reason is, by avoiding hurting animals, we actually prevent our own ability to be cruel, not just to animals, but to other human beings. So prevention of cruelty toward animals, it's ultimately prevention of cruelty toward other humans. That leads me to another important principle, and that's the principle of social justice and the connection between social justice and well-being. One of the interesting aspects of Judaism is the notion that how you treat animals, how you treat the land, how you treat vegetation, how you treat the soil is directly connected to how you treat other people. Namely, if you're morally corrupt, if we're morally corrupt, then it's going to lead not just to social corruption and to social injustice, but also to improper treatment of the natural environment. So we need to be morally right and morally upright in order to ensure that the land will be taken care of properly. How do we ensure that other human beings are treated properly? By paying attention to those who are marginal in our society, the poor, the hungry, the widow, the orphan, all of them. The Bible already tells us how we must treat them, and the Jewish tradition is very, very clear that it's the quality of the society is evident in the way we treat those who are marginal, those who are weak, those who are powerless. So the Jewish tradition makes it very clear, especially in the laws of the Sabbath and especially in the laws of the sabbatical year. I won't get into the details here, but the idea here is to ensure that people who do not have what they need to have in order to survive will have enough to live during the sabbatical year. So those are all important principles which together lead us to the notion that we need to become environmentally moral people. How do we do it? We do it by cultivating environmental virtues. We need to become virtuous people, and that takes practice. That doesn't happen by birth. We need to learn how to be environmentally correct, if you wish, but I would call it environmentally morally virtuous rather than environmentally correct. So what are the good virtues? Well, all the tradition speaks of marriage such as humility, or virtues such as humility, modesty, moderation, mercifulness. All those are ecologically very, very meaningful. If you want one word to put it all together as a concept, one word that puts it all together is the notion of eco-kosher. It was coined in roughly the end of the 60s, sometime like around 68, but it was popularized during the 1970s. It was coined by Zalman Schachter Shalomi. It was popularized by Arthur Waskow. And the idea is that we need to become eco-kosher. What it means? It means that we need to produce food morally. We cannot do anything. If we do something immorally, in an immoral way, such as producing food, then we cannot really claim to be moral. So everything we do needs to be morally generated. And that's the idea of eco-kosher that today many Jewish environmentalists really take as a guide, kind of a guideline to their environmental activism. So let me conclude by saying a few words about Jewish environmentalism today. Jewish environmentalism is a new movement in Judaism. It's roughly about 40 years old, maybe 35 years old, but it cuts across all denominations of Judaism today. There are numerous Jewish environmental organizations, both in the diaspora and in Israel, that cut across the spectrum of modern Judaism. They are engaged in all sorts of issues of concern, such as global warming, climate change, biodiversity, loss of biodiversity, deforestation, depletion of fisheries. All of those issues that I mentioned in the beginning, Jewish environmentalists are very, very engaged in. And what do they want? They want to make Judaism green. Namely, they want to green all Jewish institutions, synagogues, schools, communal organization, community centers, youth movements. That's kind of the easy part, how to be environmentally engaged. That's kind of easy. A lot of they started with all sorts of promoting sustainability, promoting sustainable practices. They're doing quite well in that regard. So it's a kind of a grassroots movement in Judaism that brought Jewish activism to the fore, and I think it's a terrific idea, and I would like it to even grow beyond what it is. So let me just conclude by saying that Jewish environmentalism is very attractive today to previously unaffiliated Jews, to Jews who have limited or no Jewish education. It's also attractive to seekers who have walked other spiritual paths, and to Jews who are traditionally observant. Oops. Sorry about that. In all of these people, we see an interest in extending the Jewish ethics of responsibility to include the environment. For other environmentally concerned Jews, we see an interest in new holistic and ecological consciousness that overcomes the disruptives of dualism of scripture versus nature. And there are also others who signify the return to earth-based spirituality that links Judaism to other traditions. However you interpret Jewish environmentalism, you will see that they're interested in communitarianism, they're interested in environmental and social justice, they're interested in educational programs, and they create a whole new positive, I would call it positive, life-affirming attitude toward the environment. So if you ask me whether Judaism is for the environment, I would say yes, very much so. And it has all the mechanisms and all the principles already within the tradition to promote environmentalism. So I hope that makes sense to you. And I agree with the premise of this lecture series that religious traditions need to work together, especially we can start with Judaism and Islam, of course, Judaism and Christianity. We need to work together to create and build a more just, verdant, and peaceful world. Thank you.
Vielen, vielen Dank für diesen wirklich sehr, sehr bereicherten Vortrag. Also ich weiß nicht, wie es Ihnen gegangen ist. Ich habe mir ganz gedacht, das Buch muss ich mir kaufen. Also es war einfach sehr, sehr vielfältig, gut strukturiert und macht einfach Interesse an mehr. Ich habe jetzt die Freude, Ihnen Frau Professor Nawal Ammar vorzustellen. Ganz kurz zu Ihrem Bildungsweg. Sie hat einen Bachelor in Soziologie aus Großbritannien, hat dann ihren Master in Stadtsoziologie gemacht und schließlich ihren PhD oder Doktorat im Bereich der Kulturanthropologie in Florida. Also ihr Studienweg war sozusagen sowohl geografisch als auch wissenschaftlich und fachlich sehr, sehr breit und sehr vielfältig. Und sie ist heute Dekanin der Human- und Sozialwissenschaftlichen Fakultät an der Rowan University in New Jersey und unterrichtet und ist Professorin dort an der Abteilung für Rechtswissenschaft. Und hat eine ganze Reihe von Lehrtätigkeiten, von akademischen Verantwortlichkeiten in verschiedenen Wissenschaftsbereichen und an verschiedenen Universitäten in Amerika und Kanada. Und sie ist neben ihrer rein akademischen Lehrtätigkeit ist sie an Projekten beteiligt, die sich einerseits mit der Frage von Frauen im Wirtschaftsleben beschäftigen. Sie hat sich auch mit Frauen mit der Frage von Frauenrollen in der arabischen Welt beschäftigt. Dann im Bereich von Gewaltprävention, was auch sehr interessante Verbindung zu Umweltschutz hat, weil auch die Umwelt, von der wir sprechen, ist ja nicht zuletzt eine menschliche Umwelt, sondern eine mitmenschliche Umwelt. Aus dem Grund finde ich die Verbindung zwischen diesen Bereichen sehr interessant. Und sie hat sich, was für uns jetzt aus Sicht der islamischen Theologie wieder sehr interessant ist, mit Fragen des Justizvollzugs beschäftigt und hier ganz besonders mit Muslimen in Gefängnissen und im Justiz, im Strafvollzug. Und sie hat natürlich auch sehr, sehr viel publiziert. Der Grund, warum sie hier eingeladen wurde, ist, dass sie geschrieben hat über Islam und Ökofeminismus. Und genau das wird sie, über diese Ansätze wird sie heute sprechen, über Ökogerechtigkeit, Ökofeminismus und aus ihrer fachlich-wissenschaftlichen Perspektive. Wir freuen uns, Frau Professor Nawal Ammar hier begrüßen zu dürfen. Dankeschön.
Good evening, everyone. I want to start by thanking the Jewish Museum for inviting me to Berlin. I haven't been to Berlin since Berlin was basically two cities, so it tells you how long I have been absent from Berlin. But it's really nice. This morning I did go to the Jewish Museum, and I didn't last for too long. It reminded me of a number of things. I actually grew up in civil war situation, and I can tell you the environment is very near and dear to me because of that. So I want to start by saying it is hard to stand in front of you here today and speak about an Islamic environmental perspective without acknowledging the religious crises in Islam. Our collective suffering, both in the West and the East, from repeated violence against innocent people in the name of Islam, is only one manifestation of Islamic crises. However, the present religious crises in Islam, while of paramount importance, are not a valid way to measure Islam's long-enduring complex heritage and its future prospects. Islam is 15 centuries old, and to measure it by the last 50 or 60 years is really not fair. It is important to remember that one of the complex heritages of Islam is its perspective on the environment, ecology, and nature. And there is no doubt, the more I heard from our previous speaker, the more I thought, oh, we could do such a nice comparison between Judaism and Islam. I won't do that, and I'm happy to speak about it in the Q&A. What I actually want to do is more present a general ideological perspective that is lacking in Islamic academic discourse. So before I speak about anything, I want to bring to your attention a few issues. And the most important one is that there is no unified Islamic perspective. There are between 1.6 and 1.8 billion Muslims who live all over the world. These Muslims live in majority Islamic countries and minority Islamic countries. These Muslims live in diverse geographic regions. Nearly two-thirds of Muslims live in the Asia-Pacific region and not in the Middle East. The country with the largest number of Muslims is Indonesia. The Muslim community speaks many languages and dialects in their daily life, including Arabic, English, French, Urdu, Hausa, Persian, Turkish, Indonesian, and I can go on and on. Muslims live in oil-rich countries that have the highest GDPs per capita in the world, and in countries that have very low GDPs per capita in the world. Hence, within this diversity, it is not possible to speak about one Islamic perspective, and I have no delusion about that. However, it is possible to speak about an Islamic perspective. This perspective is not advancing new interpretations on Islam and the environment, but rather a retrieval of existing theological elements of the message that the Prophet Muhammad brought to Arabia in the 7th century. My perspective, and it is not only mine, but the one I'm presenting to you here, is a progressive approach that is based on the concept of aql, which literally translates as the brain, but it means knowledge transmitted from independent reason, versus naql, which is knowledge derived only from revelation and tradition. Naql literally translates as copying or imitation. Here I utilize this distinction from an old Islamic school of thought, namely the Mu'tazila. It is not a Western perspective. Rational thinking is not a Western perspective only. And the Mu'tazilite rationalists are well known in the history of Islam, and I'll come to that in a second. One of the many theological discussions in early Islamic periods centered on questions of divine justice and human responsibility, such as whether the evils as perceived in the world were created by God or caused by humans, and the issue of predestination versus free will. Mu'tazili thinkers stressed God's wisdom and goodness and exonerated him of the responsibility for evils and injustices in the world. The Mu'tazili sought to ground the Islamic creedal system in reason, though with the Quran and a foundational faith in Islam as their starting point and ultimate reference. Overall, they believe that human reason, aql, can discover spiritual truths, that reason is useful in complementing spiritual intuition, and that reason is actually necessary for rightly interpreting any prophetic revelation. In support of this, one Quranic verse states, "The vilest of all creatures in the sight of Allah are those deaf and dumb ones who do not use their rationality." The Mu'tazili perspective had flourished during a time when the Muslim Caliph Al-Ma'mun supported it. And after he died, his descendants gradually opposed these ideas on the grounds that they are foreign to Islamic culture and that true knowledge can be transmitted only from revelation and tradition and copied in that way. And other forms of knowledge are bid'ah, meaning innovation, novelty, and heretical doctrine. This presentation that I'm giving does not speak on behalf of Islam as a totality, but instead provides an educated systemic perspective based on the idea that human reason can discover spiritual truth. I will be speaking about four issues. The first provides a brief description of the Islamic view of the environment, which actually parallels quite a bit the Judaic tradition. Second, I will discuss the moral challenges emanating from this view of the environment for Muslims. The third presents examples of the environmental conditions of contemporary Islamic societies, and in doing so, I'm not criticizing, I'm critiquing. The fourth and final section advances an Islamic response at the theoretical level to the environmental crisis. Happy to discuss the actual details in the Q&A. A view of an Islamic environmental ethic sees most Muslims would agree that the sources of Islam, anywhere we're going to interpret anything, are we have to look at the Quran or the holy book, which Muslims believe to be God's words, transmitted through the angel Gabriel to the Prophet Muhammad. And Hadith and Sunnah, which are the sayings and traditions of the Prophet that were committed to writing after he passed away. Fiqh, which is jurisprudence, or madhahib, which is schools of law. They all come together under fiqh. And the sharia, which are paths of law, which are human written. These sources are not considered to be of equal weight. The Quran is the most sacred source because it contains the words of God, The rest are perceived as human-made doctrines and don't have the same level of sacredness. And it's important to put this and focus on it, because today there are lots of Muslims who have raised the Prophet's sayings to the sacredness of the Quran, hence the problem. But from these sources, we learn that protecting the environment and all God's creation for Muslims is a duty and not a choice. This duty comes from Islam's Tawheed paradigm, or the paradigm of unity. Paradigm of unity means strict monotheism. That is, the Quran clearly says, He is Allah, the one and only, Allah, the eternal absolute. He begetteth not, nor is he begotten, and there is none unto him. God is one and is not like anything we know. He is neither born nor will give birth. He's almighty, and he's nothing like we know in humanity. So Islam does not attribute sacredness to anything but to God. That includes nature. Because to attribute sacredness to nature is basically to associate other beings with God, and that is against Tawheed and the oneness of God. Shirk. The oneness of God brings about two categories of relations in Islam. The first relation is between God, the creator, and the created, including the environment. The environment here is perceived as not sacred, but a reflection of God's creation, hence making it sacred. So it's a second order of sacredness, not in and of itself. Islam views the environment as God's creation to be revered because it is a manifestation of the one Almighty's power, and not because itself is sacred. The second level, so the created and the creation is one level of relation. The second level of relationship includes all creatures, the world of things, plants and animals, humans, jinn and angels, heaven and earth, paradise and hell. This creation of God, though diverse, still is united, muwahada, the tawheed, the unity, and is alike in a number of ways, including their common origin, they all originate in water, in their having social structures as communities, and their obedience to God. The created are equal and dependent in their relationship to God, and are interdependent in the relationship with each other. So there is no doubt that humans are interdependent on nature, not dependent on nature. Coward argues that Islam is unique among Western religions in that stars and molecules, plants, animals, and humans all worship God. Nature not only joins humans in worshiping God, but by its very existence displays God's potentialities and attributes. So Muslims are basically view the environment not as sacred, but as a reflection of the sacred. To this point, at the textual level, the issue that Islam is nature affirming is not difficult to understand. Nature is not sacred, but is respected because it is a creation of the divine God. However, this perspective of a nature-affirming Islam becomes more complicated when using and protecting the earth is assigned to humans, no different from Judaism and Christianity. Humans, both men and women, are the custodians of earth. The word is khalifa. They are khalifa, and I'm happy to talk about that word specifically because there are people who argue that khalifa is masculine. Khalifa actually is neither masculine nor feminine. And then in the Quranic verses where Khalifa is designated as, Muslims are designated as the Khalifa or the stewards or vice regents of the earth, humans are mentioned as humans. And only in the second verse, Adam is mentioned. And Adam in Islamic context is a male, he's not neutral. Humans, both men and women, are the custodians of earth. vice-regents on earth who will be responsible for not only maintaining its order and harmony for God, but improving it as well. Humans were entrusted with the responsibility of Khalifa because God offered the trust to the heavens, the earth, and the mountains, but they refused to shoulder responsibility out of fear. That's a Quranic verse. But humans assumed it, accepted it, and they did that when they became Muslims, i.e., witnessed the oneness of God. So as a condition of Islam, you hear about the pillars and you hear about all that. As a condition of Islam, Muslims basically have to are vice regents of the environment, or else they have not borne witness to God's oneness. Muslims are to care for God's creation as part of their devotional duties, and they will be held accountable on the Day of Judgment if they do not fulfill this responsibility. This role of Khalifa is presented as a test to humans. It is a test about whether humans are capable of protecting this earth from corruption. Just as if they're capable to fast, if they're capable to give almsgiving, again, the protection of the earth is a test in that way. The Quranic verse says, "Behold, God said to the angels, I will create a vice regent on earth. They said, will you place one who will make mischief and shed blood?" This responsibility of not corrupting the earth is hard to shoulder and challenging for Muslims, because Islam is not an aesthetic religion commanding detachment from worldly goods. Humans in Islam have a twofold relationship with nature, earth, and the universe. On the one hand, they are nature's managers, but they are also its users. The Quran commands humans to enjoy the bounties of the earth. The Quranic verse notes, "Do you not see that Allah has subjected to your use all things on the heavens and on earth and has made his bounties flow to you in exceeding measure, both seen and unseen?" Quran also says, "The ornaments of life are money and children." There lies the dilemma or the test for Muslims. The subjugation of earth to humans is always attached to a moral dimension of use, but not abuse, and use, but not abstention. For Muslims, the issue of keeping the equilibrium between having been charged with managing the earth and bettering it, and at the same time using its bounties for the fulfillment, is one of the important tests to reaching the gardens of heaven. The middle way, and many people who have studied Buddhism or know about Buddhism think that the middle way is a Buddhist term. Well, the middle way is also an Islamic way of life. The middle way is the suggested mode of behaving to guarantee this equilibrium. The Quran identifies the middle way in behaviors clearly when it states, "We have made you true Muslims, a moderate nation, so that you could be an example for all people." Again, the Quran repeats this equilibrium and middle way, "And let not your hand be tied like a miser to your neck, nor stretch it forth to its utmost reach like a spendthrift, so that you become blameworthy and in severe poverty." So it's clear that basically Muslims are enjoined to protect the earth, not because it's sacred, but because it's a reflection of sacredness. They also have to use a middle way to preserve it, and not only to preserve it, but to improve it for the next generations. David Loy, who is one of my favorite Buddhist scholars, in 2000 warns us that it is ludicrous to think that conventional religious institutions or doctrine, as we know them today, can play a significant role in solving the environmental crisis. 17 years later, his warning is even more relevant for Muslims, for unless the existing religious and social behaviors change, it is hard to see how Muslims can play a constructive role in this environmental crisis. In 2015, faith leaders, senior international development policymakers, academics, and other experts made the call in a new Islamic declaration on climate change for 1.6 billion Muslims to strongly support the Paris Agreement. Proud to say that, having come from the United States. Drafted in Istanbul, the declaration urges politicians to agree to limit global warming to 2 degrees centigrade. 2, asks Muslims, in the words of the Quran, not to strut arrogantly on the earth. 3, calls for all people, leaders, and businesses to commit to 100% renewable energy. And 4, calls on the rich countries to recognize their moral obligation to reduce consumption. However, and despite the declaration, not too many behaviors responsible for the corruption of the earth have changed. Alvarez and Paranajos in 2012 note that gas and oil operations are considered a major source of pollutants of water, air, and soil. Mahdi in 2017, a journalist, noted that Saudi Arabia increased its oil exports and production to the highest average monthly rate on record. The average production for 2016 was 0.26 million barrels more than the year before. A World Health Organization and International Energy Agency data for 2016 shows 3 Muslim countries out of 135 to be among the highest polluted in the world. Those are Saudi Arabia, Qatar, and Egypt. Population growth, which is also a problem when we talk about environmental and ecological crises. Lipka and Hackett in 2016 note that while the world's population is projected to grow 32% by 2060, the number of Muslims is expected to increase by 70% in 2060. That is 38% more than the world population. The question of population growth is often challenged when dealing with environmental crises, because there is a difference between the pressure populations impose on the environment in industrialized countries versus developing countries. An additional person in an industrial country no doubt consumes far more and places far greater pressure on natural resources than an additional person in the developing countries. Regardless, however, 38% more than the world population in terms of growth, there has to be a limit to growth. Boundless growth of Earth's population anywhere at that rate increases consumption and waste, which will eventually exhaust the Earth's carrying capacity. More examples of Muslim countries' irresponsibility towards the environment. Excessive deforestation taking place in Indonesia. The loss of 3.9 million hectares of forest in the years between 1990 and 2000. High levels of water stress registered in every country in the Muslim Middle East, except in Iraq, because Iraq had other problems. Since 2003. The country with the highest level of pollution in the world in 2015 was the United Arab Emirates. Muslim citizens, according to a Pew Global Attitudes survey in 2010, expressed the lowest level of support to pay higher prices to support efforts of improving the environment. What to do to change the conventional understanding of the religious doctrine and institutions that is not working? An Islamic response to the environmental crisis is difficult. I'm going to present basically a theoretical. There are lots, and I can give you in the Q&A, lots of ways and lots of thinkers who have introduced very concrete steps. But what I want to do is go beyond the concrete steps and talk about the actual theology, the actual religious institutions, and the doctrine itself, and retrieve it so that we can convince people who can't be convinced, at least through empirical, because there is this idea that this environmental crisis is an invention of the West. Not only Trump thinks that way. Sayyid Hussein Nasser says the environmental crisis in... Sayyid Hussein Nasser is the founder of Islamic environmentalism in any country, in any language. He basically says the environmental crisis is an externalization of the darkness of the soul of modern humans. For Muslims living in our contemporary world, this darkness of the soul is a result of disregarding Islamic teachings both generally and towards God's creation, both in nature and culture. Many of the center issues in Islam have been of little concern to Muslims and Muslim leaders today. I would argue that Muslims and Muslim leaders today have deviated from many of the essential themes and have involved themselves in ritualistic practices and the irrelevant minutiae of religious dogma. Islam, nevertheless, did not leave its human adherents, the Khalifas, with an impossible task to perform as custodians of the earth. At least two clear religious and institutional paths are rightly available to overcome the present environmental crisis that can help us rediscover the lost elements and faculties within our souls. These are reason and thinking and transformative action. And while for many people these are common, these are really essential ideas in this Islamic dogmatic world that we are living in today. Reason and thinking are very much part of the Islamic theology. The Quran has many references to the issue of critical, not artificial thinking and reflection. The Quran mentions knowing as wisdom, knowing as understanding, knowing right from wrong, and knowing as learning. The responsibility of humans to balance between their needs and the needs of other creatures created by God is reliant on Muslims knowing the consequences of their action. However, knowing the consequences of their action, both in terms of impact on the environment and its moral imperative, seems to be more difficult to attain than one thinks during this time of the Muslim community's history. Many Muslims either cannot read Quranic Arabic or cannot read at all. There is a high illiteracy rate in Muslim countries. Additionally, many Muslims and Muslim countries have become suspicious of intellectualism and science. Hence, the level of knowing has deteriorated to the point that myth and ideology direct the course of many human affairs in Muslim countries. While there is variation among Muslim countries, it is not an exaggeration to argue that most of the educational curriculum in Muslim countries depends on rote memorization and includes little space for the development of critical or independent thinking. Hud Bohoy shows that the level of scientific and intellectual productivity in the Muslim world by noting that in 2007, this is as far as I can get data from, Muslim world by noting that in 2007, the seven most productive Muslim countries combined produced fewer scientific papers than did India itself. Similarly, a US Patent and Trademark Office report in 2009 shows that in the 36 years between 1963 and 2009, the 57 countries of the Organization of the Islamic Conference, OIC, obtained half of the patents awarded to Norway, constituting less than 0.06% of the patents granted worldwide over the same period. Today, only one Muslim country invests more than 1% of its GDP on research and development, and that is Tunisia. This is the educational achievement and scientific productivity of an Islamic world that was a pioneer in scientific knowledge, architecture, and art at some point in its history. This is a community that has many religious commands on learning and knowledge that the following Quranic verse exemplifies. My Lord, enrich me with knowledge. This lack of knowledge creates biased, unjust, and fabricated ideas and values. For example, the maltreatment of women is such an idea that requires to be challenged and questioned. The Quran and the Prophet's sayings and traditions speak to women's rights and responsibilities very clearly. Islam denies the concept of women as seductresses, responsible for the original sin and fall of humankind. Islam sees males and females as equal, evident in many chapters of the Quran. This equity of the sexes reflects the grace of God. As the Quran says, and Allah has made for you from yourselves spouses, and has made for you from your spouses children and grandchildren, and has provided for you from the good things. This spirit of equity between men and women, however, is not generally prevalent in contemporary Muslim countries. And I just want to say this, this is not in the translation, and I'll say it slowly. The there is only two articles of ecofeminism in Islam, and they're both written by me. And I am not the biggest environmentalist in the world. There are better and bigger people than me. But to say that today there are only two articles on ecofeminism in Islam written by one person is just a reflection of how little we have sought knowledge in the Islamic world and Islamic scholars. Ecofeminism is the idea that the deprecating earth or the destroying of the earth is basically a similar practice to the disrespect of women and their attached. And I actually do think that until and unless women in the Islamic world regain some of their rights, there will be no hope for averting the environmental crisis that's coming, that's here. The second idea that I want to talk about is transformative action. This second path to resolving the moral test of being khalifas is open to debate in Islam, this transformative action. Some Muslims argue that the failure of humans to fulfill their eternal destiny of protecting the earth is the will of God. It is predestined, and human action is of no consequence. Other believers disagree with this view of predestination in Islam, and there is a long historic debate within Islamic thought on human will and action. It is clear from many Quranic verses and prophetic traditions that action has a role in human destiny. Hence, the Quranic verse says, "Never will I suffer to be lost the work of any of you, be he male or female. You are members of one another." This action that humans are enjoined to take is not only one that negates evil, but is one that involves good deeds. As such, the Quran states, "Let there be among you a group of people who order good, al-ma'ruf, and prohibit evil, al-munkar." The action component requires humans to keenly utilize knowledge not only in their ritualistic worship or individuals' daily life, but also in protecting all God's creatures and creations as his vicegerents on earth. The Quran says, "God is the one who created life and death to test you. Which of you is best in action?" This action for humans is clearly prescribed in Islamic text as not exceeding the balance. The Quranic verse says, "In order that you may not transgress due balance," as a result, the equilibrium, the middle way. These actions and deeds do not differentiate between ones toward humans or other creatures of God. As such, a saying of the prophet notes, "A good deed done to a beast is as good as doing a good deed to a human being, while an act of cruelty to a beast is as bad as an act of cruelty to human beings." These good deeds, according to Islam, are not only done for the day of judgment, but should be done for the here and now. Hence, the prophet enjoined Muslims to work in this world as though they are living forever and work for the hereafter as though they are dying tomorrow. The more engagement the action has, the higher its value. The Prophet Muhammad's famous saying, and it's for many of us who grew up in an Islamic culture, this is repeated to you all the time. So the more engagement in the action has, the higher its value. The Prophet Muhammad's famous saying clearly underscores this when he says, "Anyone who witnesses evil should protest it by their hand, by their mouth, or by their heart. The last is the weakest of the faith." This action is necessary. And it is necessary because without it, we will never be able to save anything or to be khalifas or vice-regents. The Quran notes, "Allah changeth not the condition of a folk until they first change that which is in their hearts." And as a result, unless Muslims go in to really retrieving their actual tradition and be responsible for the earth, they will never, ever contribute to the improvement of the environment or averting the environmental crisis. The problem, however, at this point is time. I'm going to leave you with that problem. Thank you.
Wir haben jetzt ausgemacht, dass beide Referentinnen jeweils 5 Minuten Zeit haben, um sozusagen auf die Ausführungen der jeweiligen anderen Sprecherin einzugehen. Das heißt, wir bitten Frau Professor Tirosh um ein kurzes Statement sozusagen zu dem, was Frau Ammar gesprochen hat und umgekehrt.
Thank you. It was most enjoyable to listen to your speech, and I didn't prepare any formal response to it since I just listened to it as we all did on the spot. But I guess respond to 3 things. First of all, I fully agree with you that Judaism and Islam share an awful lot in common, and it might be a good idea maybe one time to compare the similarity between Judaism and Islam on the one hand versus Christianity on the other hand, and why do we have those differences? So that's a suggestion for another topic. I also would like to suggest and get historical information. The Mu'tazilites are very important in the history of Jewish philosophy. We would not have had Jewish philosophy without the Mu'tazilites. So our first medieval Jewish philosopher, that's Sa'adia Gaon, was a Mu'tazilite. So it's really remarkable how much we share. And the third point is on ecofeminism. I'm also the only Jew who has written about ecofeminism. So we are here in the same boat. Ecofeminism in general has made very little impression on Jewish discourse on environmentalism, and it's really, I would say, somewhat shameful because ecofeminism is so important. But most Jewish thinkers really are not familiar with ecofeminism. So maybe we should do something together to bring the ecofeminist message to the world. On the whole, I think that to go to the environmental challenges that you posed to us. Maybe Islam has more of a burden because there are more Muslims. There are only 14 million Jews in the world, so they cannot really make that much destruction. There are only 14 million of them as opposed to 1.5 billion Muslims. So in that sense, Judaism can get away with it easily. On the other hand, I think that the approach of the two traditions is absolutely the same. The focus on responsibility, the focus on law, the focus on wisdom. They are understanding that the natural world is not inherently sacred, that it is really divine creation or reflection of divine unity and divine uniqueness. So theologically, philosophically, historically, Judaism and Islam have an awful lot in common. So I would like to suggest that as we go forward in addressing the environmental crisis, we find more ways to collaborate. Now, I come from Israel. I don't know if you mentioned that, but I come from Israel, and actually there is a lot more. At least there were attempts to start environmental collaboration between Israel, the Palestinian authorities, and Jordan, less so with Egypt. But it's happening. It's happening not as much as it could happen. But people need to know that there are some success stories in that regard, and we need to do much more in it. So I think that environmentalism is one way to start addressing larger issues such as the environmental crisis and, of course, the problem of peace all over the world. So in the Middle East, we experience that challenge on a daily basis, and environmentalism could be the beginning of collaboration and cooperation. So I tend, by nature, I'm an optimistic person, so I tend to think that maybe good things will happen, but we obviously have serious, serious problems, and maybe it's more acute in the Islamic world than it is in the Jewish world.
So that's the difference between somebody who's a sociologist and somebody who's a religious studies. I'm not an optimist. Okay. I try very hard to be an optimist, just to be in a rational way. But let me just go back. I actually I'm actually a criminologist. My vocation has been that of studying the criminal institutions. I came to the issue of environment in 1994 after being asked to come and speak at Whistler, British Columbia, by a famous Canadian religious studies person who's a historian, Harold Cowart, who basically came to me saying, I want you to write something on justice and the environment. Why is it that injustice is leading to environmental destruction in Islam? So I have, it's very interesting, as I was hearing, so a lot of what I wrote and have written about the environment comes from this perspective of justice, the idea that a lot of injustice is happening in the Muslim world. The leaders are not democratic and they're authoritarian. Women are disrespected. There's injustice in distribution of income. There's injustice in distribution of health and access to health between men and women. There's injustice, injustices over and over that all have led to what we're seeing today. That is not inherent in the Muslim theology and culture in general, because one of the most just, there's a very famous story about the just, one of the second leader in the Islamic world after the death of the Prophet Muhammad. There is this jurisprudence idea that you have to cut the thief's hand, right hand, if he or she steals. Well, during a famine in Arabia, basically he suspended it and said, in any unjust society, no one is to be punished, including those who steal for food. And I always say, show me a Muslim society or world or country that is just, and then we can do whatever we want. So a lot of what you said is very, a lot of what is in the Jewish tradition in terms of action, in terms of, so I haven't called it eco-kosher, which is really interesting, but I've written...
Eco-halal, eco-kosher and eco-halal is very similar.
But halal is also has acquired a really interesting meaning that relates immediately to food and meat, right? And at least in the Western culture. I've called it adab for those, and it's basically, adab has been translated as reserved action or reserved behavior, right? Behavior that is respectful of the world. And if we have respectful behaviors, that is, keep equilibrium, don't misuse resources such as water, don't pollute by extracting oil so that you can basically compete in the market, and it's a weapon of war at this point, the extra extraction of oil. It's a weapon of war, so Iran can never, ever, gain any advantage in the capitalist market of the oil. So it's a weapon of war, it's not anything else, and it is really polluting. So a lot of the things about conservation, agriculture, slaughtering of animals, all of the things that you mentioned about the Judaic tradition is very much an Islamic, is in the Islamic world. But also more so than Christianity, because Judaism and Islam thrived in very similar ecologies. So a lot of what is prescribed is very much prescribed. And that it has been written. There is a huge group of environmentalists in Saudi Arabia who have been very active and have done, and they're funded very, very highly by one of the Saudi princes, because he is an environmentalist. Mm-hmm. However, they are so marginalized, both in Saudi Arabia and in the scholarly tradition of environmentalism. So that is my first gut reaction of, wow, I could be standing up there and saying these things in about Islam, right?
Yeah. No, it's interesting. In the field of religion and ecology, we always get to the point, so who's going to represent Islam? So it's finding the Islamic scholar is always a challenge. And I would love to know more, if we can identify more people who can be part of the conversation, that would be great.
Happy to tell you. Most of them are not in, most of them are basically in England. Mm. Those who are in Europe are in England, and they have really, and then the others are either in Saudi Arabia or in Qatar. And they are highly funded, but they write, they don't write much in English.
Also es gibt auch jetzt eine ganz neue akademische Bewegung in Deutschland von jungen Aktivisten, die sich sozusagen mit der Idee von islamischen Umweltschutz in Abschlussarbeiten, Doktorarbeiten und so weiter auseinandersetzen. Also auch hier gibt es eine neue Bewegung, auch im deutschsprachigen Raum. Man wird sehen, was rauskommt. Gut, ich eröffne das Forum. Hier sitzt deine übrigens. Ich eröffne das Forum für Fragen.
Ich wundere mich trotzdem, dass von der Wirtschaft nicht die Rede war. Und zum Zweiten ist der Lebensstil eine Frage.
So now maybe we can say something critical, but yes, definitely you're right. The economy is, as we used to say in the United States, the economy is stupid. I don't know if you know that expression from the election season. James Carville said that it's the economy, stupid, right? So the economy is always very, very important, and lifestyle issues are very important. So let me be a little bit more critical of the some Jewish lifestyle. One of the major challenges for environmentalism, at least in the United States, is upper mobility, upper social mobility, and definitely if you have environmental concerns, you're going to be critical of some of the practices among American Jews. Let's say I've been critical in public, so I can share it here. For example, the very lavish parties for bar mitzvahs. Those lavish parties that can go up in cost, $50,000 is not unusual for a party for a 13-year-old boy or girl. So I think that's definitely an excessive expense. But we definitely can do better by lowering that kind of thrust toward upper mobility. So on that regard, I will be on the same page with you. If you are environmentally concerned, then you have to be for lowering the standard of living, not improving standard of living. That raises its own problems, and that's always the environmental movement kind of has a streak of austerity in it, and you have to be very careful not to go overboard here. But clearly, I think that American Jews can do a little bit better by lowering their desire for increase in life, in standard of living. So that would be my economic response. Other than that, we can always do better. So I'm not condoning what's going on. I think that we can definitely improve.
So I did mention initially about the disparity between the richest countries and the poorest countries, and in Islam it's a very clear one of the pillars of Islam is almsgiving. And almsgiving, the whole idea of almsgiving is to redistribute. It's not taxation in the regressive way, it's taxation in a progressive way. However, if you look at the rich countries, in terms of, I would say, Saudi Arabia, Kuwait, and Qatar, and now Qatar and Saudi Arabia don't even talk to each other, United Arab Emirates, right? If you look at the almsgiving, it's really, it's nothing. And it has now modernized itself in terms of military support or support of certain ideologies, but it is not almsgiving to a redistribution. So at the country level, that is a real issue. And again, retrieving the origin of what almsgiving is for. It is not a ritualistic idea, spending 15% of your capital and however much on your money, cash, and so on. It is the essence of it is redistribution of income so that no one person sleeps hungry in Islam. And that is a very, I remember learning this as a child, that no one person should basically sleep hungry in the Islamic world, given the riches of the Islamic world. Well, that's not true now. In the minority Muslim countries, and I want to use the United States as a good example, Muslims in the United States have fared very well. They are among the highest educated. They have done very well financially. And what has happened is they have, as they say in English, involuted. They have basically become isolated, partly because of the attacks from the outside, but partly because they basically feel that they have done well and they have no obligation towards anyone else. But again, redistribution of income is not limited. In the Islamic State, the redistribution of income is not limited to only Muslims, because also non-Muslims pay a jizya, some kind of a tax. So the Islamic State includes everyone, and those who are not living in majority Muslim countries should be part of that state in the redistribution of income. One more thing, there's a principle in Islam of banking, and it is, now, most of the people who have promoted Islamic banking have not done it well. They have not been, they've been much more of capitalists than they should be, right? I mean, Islamic banking goes against the capitalistic ideas, right? And it goes against basically the profit from something that is not there, from speculation. It's not usury, it's speculation that Islamic banking eliminates. You can only bank and get profit on what is there, not what you will speculate on, which is very much the Western capitalist banking systems. So Islam is full of these ideas, but when they're implemented, somehow something interferes and it gets spoiled.
Thank you very much. Bitte.
Wenn ich recht informiert bin, dann geht das Christentum aus dem Judentum hervor. Und der Islam letztendlich ist ohne Judentum auch undenkbar. Jetzt meine Überlegung, hat dann nicht das Judentum, obwohl zahlenmäßig recht klein, eine fast Avantgarde-Funktion, muss dann nicht das Judentum besonders darauf hinweisen, dass wir zum Beispiel mit grenzenlosem Wachstum nichts bewegen können?
You're absolutely right that in the West, definitely the Abrahamic traditions ultimately are all derived from Judaism. So the Islam and Christianity both are derived from Judaism to some extent. However, we should not forget that another factor in the story was very important historically speaking, and that's Greek thinking. The difference between Judaism and Christianity has much to do with the impact of Greek thinking on Christianity in a way that it did not happen in the same way, at least, in Judaism and to a lesser extent in Islam. So something has shifted when Judaism became transformed into Christianity and preached to the Greco-Roman world. It has changed. So that change is what we need to understand. And I would say, theologically speaking, intellectually speaking, it has to do with dualism. Christianity is dualistic in a way that neither Judaism nor Islam are dualistic. So we need to understand why that dualism introduced, in my view, a lot of negative aspect, at least vis-a-vis the natural world. So that would be a kind of an historical answer. On the avant-garde nature of Judaism, I don't have a problem with it. I come from Israel. We are a product of an avant-garde culture. I'm a child, and my husband is a child of pioneers. So definitely they understood themselves in avant-garde terms. Does that mean that each and every Jew today think of himself or herself in avant-garde terms? Probably not. Probably not. So what exactly does it mean to be an avant-garde? What is the pioneer? Environmentally, I like to think that all Jews should be endorsing environmental ideas and environmental practices. Does that mean that it's the case? No, it's not the case. Many Jews do not care about environmentalism. So I have to admit that. Environmentalism is still small. It's a growing movement, and I think it can become even more paramount as we go along, simply because the problems will become more severe. Maybe this is a good point to mention something about technology. Israel is actually at the forefront of many technological advancement, including in agriculture. Many of the innovations in agriculture today come from Israel, and they're doing very well. So technology can be part of the solution, but we cannot believe that technology will solve all our environmental problems. That's absolutely not true. That's where we need religious ethics and religious orientation to help us think through what technology can do. But I think that some solutions will come from technology. I just read a beautiful essay about solar roads, how solar roads that are going to be created in the next 10 to 20 years are going to solve many of our energy problems. So there are going to be technological solutions, but how to change attitudes, values, approaches, that does not come from technology. It comes ultimately from religious perspectives.
Es geht jetzt darum, also meine Frage geht, weil jetzt hier die islamischen Länder bzw. arabische Länder haben so wenig getan für die Umwelt. Und das ist jetzt darum, sie sind nicht beteiligt in den jetzigen Bewegungen, die sogenannte Umweltbewegung und so weiter. Sie haben gar nichts getan. Aber es gibt Gründe, stimmt das oder nicht? Aber dieser Aspekt nicht ja.
It's hard to say yes or no on this, because there are lots of efforts. So Egypt, for example, has an environmental minister of the environment, and they have been women, right? So there's been action, but the action is basically not institutional. It is, it's personal. One prince funds this research. One president puts a minister. It's not an idea that has, and it's had very little impact. I mean, I'll give you an example. 6 o'clock in the morning, driving from one end of Cairo to the other, you can't breathe. You see things, I grew up in Cairo. I mean, you could wake up at 6 o'clock in the morning and wait for the bus, nobody was, but you can't breathe anymore because of the pollution, right? I don't think that is simply because, I agree, consumerism is one, male development is another. There are lots of reasons for it. But also, as we heard, I think religion, in my opinion, the environmental problem is not a biological issue. It is a human behavioral issue. And I don't know how many I've seen garbage all over and if you're talking about Arab countries only, Arab countries are not only Muslim countries, to respect all the minorities in the Arab countries as well. So Arab countries are not a product of only Islam, but they are also a product of all sorts of other things. So the maldevelopment has really created problems for people to say, what do I care about the environment? I need to feed myself. And there are people who say that, and many of them.
Es war hier eine Frage.
Ja, hallo. Ja. Vielen Dank vorab für den...
Sie zuerst und die zweite Frage ist dann von dort. Okay.
Vielen Dank für den sehr informativen, interessanten Vortrag. Ich kann Sie auch beruhigen, ich arbeite zurzeit an einem Artikel zum Thema Ökofeminismus und Islam. Also vielleicht wird das dann der dritte Artikel werden. Genau, was ich fragen wollte, ich merke eben, dass dieser akademische Diskurs auf dieser Theorie bleibt, haften bleibt, in der es darum geht, diese Aussagen zu tätigen und zu wiederholen. Aber ich frage mich, welche Konsequenzen müsste man jetzt im nächsten Schritt gehen? Was würden Sie, wenn Sie morgen zwei Autoritäten aus dem muslimischen oder jüdischen religiösen Umfeld begegnen würden, was würden Sie ihnen mitteilen als Akademiker, wie man das fruchtbar machen könnte, wie man Umweltschutz wirklich, das, was Sie praktisch gesagt haben, umsetzen kann. Verstehen Sie? Ich hoffe schon.
I hope so. okay, so first of all, let me agree with you partially. I do agree that there is a difference between talking about environmentalism and being involved in environmental activism. That's definitely the case. On some level, I agree also, that's the second point, that the theoretical conversation has reached where it could reach. We have all the data. We have all the principles. I agree. And we've been there, I agree with you also, 30 to 40 years. So where I disagree with you is on the issue of activism. There is a lot more activism today than there was in the 1970s. I don't want to bore people here with the list of Jewish organizations, but I can give you from the top of my head at least 30 organizations. They didn't exist prior to 1986. So the fact that there is more Jewish activism means that there is more openness to it. It's even more so among Christian organizations. So I work quite a lot with churches, let's say in Phoenix, Arizona, and Christian environmentalism is very engaged. Now, does it solve our problems? No. Is it going to deal with consumerism? No. Is it going to deal with capitalism? No. Capitalism is here to stay. Ain't going to go anywhere, right? So you can say in the end, environmentalism only scratches the surface. Where is the, why am I an optimist? I'm an optimist because most of the solutions are local. They're not global so much. Mm-hmm. They're local. It begins with composting in your own municipality. I would like to see a lot more of that done, even in a place as hot as Phoenix, Arizona. We can do much better in local composting, for example. We can do so much more in education, starting from very early on. First graders should be involved in environmental work. Okay? So in that sense, I think we are today much more advanced on environmental activism than we were. And the third point, interfaith collaboration. There's a lot more interfaith collaboration today. The organization Power and Light in the United States, Green Faith, those are organizations that are very involved in interfaith collaboration. I would like to see more of that. So if we do all of those things, work locally, across religious traditions, and across all aspects of society, especially in education, we can achieve an awful lot.
Thank you very much.
So I'd like to say that the discussion at the theoretical level on Islam and the environment has reached a point of saturation. It has not. You still, when you talk about the environment, people say to you, well, but that's God's will. You know, it is one of the signs of doomsday. This is one of the littler signs of doomsday. You still hear it today from some of the most educated people, right? So I think the theoretical discussion has not gotten to where it should be, specifically in majority Muslim countries, because unfortunately, majority Muslim countries are maldeveloped at every level, from leadership to economics to production to education to healthcare. We can go on. So religion is, I had that same reaction of when Harold Coward called me in 1993, 94, said to me, you need to write an article like this. And I said, why? You know, what, I don't care. Religion isn't going to get us anywhere. Until I got to really understand that religion is one of the main components. It's not enough to go into specifically majority Muslim countries and say, you know, we need to do this. When you say it's a devotional challenge, it is as much of a devotional challenge as praying, as almsgiving, as fasting, right? As all these other things, as believing in one God, right? When you say that unless you do that, you're going to hell, to many people, the argument really loses its strength and power. As a sociologist, as a social scientist, I really believe that no one factor is ever going to solve the situation. Life is intersectionalities and complicated in humans. For me to give you a solution, I don't have a final solution. All I have is that we need to continue the discussion and continue the action in the sense of not only at the local level, but take the local things that have worked and take them to other places and say, this has worked here, let's do this. This has worked here, let's do recycling. So in Canada, I lived 10 years in Canada. Recycling is a big story. And I remember when we moved to Canada, it was a headache. It was like, oh my God, I have to put things here and here. And then on every 2 weeks, I have to take this one. Just that kind of idea of recycling. Mm-hmm. Came back to the US, recycling is really at a minimum compared to Canada. right? And so what I do now is I recycle in a way that we recycled in Canada. It's simple. Behavioral modification is easy if you enforce it, right? Otherwise, you'll have garbage for 2 weeks in Canada if you don't recycle the way you recycle, right? So there are some things that are working. In Egypt, there is no garbage collection. There are no public, there's no public institution that collects garbage. It's an individual private, and there are many stories about, and it's a mafia, right?
In the United States, too. The garbage collection, I think, has a lot of...
of mafia, too, yeah, especially in New Jersey. But let's leave it at that. The issue is so complex that each one of us has to contribute in their own strength, and we hope that that will get us somewhere.
Let me add to that optimistic note one more thing that I forgot to mention. I'm in a university that really prizes itself on its advancement in science and technology, okay? And we are very strong in sustainability studies. They finally recognized that science and technology alone are not going to make a dent on the sustainability problems of the world. And now they're getting to the point they're saying, let's bring the religious studies people, let's bring the ethicists to the conversation. That's a new development. It only has begun in the last 2 years. I think it will take off. And once religious thinkers, religious leaders, religious educators are brought to the table, and together they deal with people who are interested in science and technology and policy to solve our problems, maybe there will be a move forward.
I would like to know what your point is, if nature has a value in itself which needs to be preserved, or if it only has a value because it's valuable for humanity.
As far as vision for the good life, you're right. All of us have to think constantly on the concept of what is the good life, who is a good person, what does it mean to be good. I wrote a whole book, a huge book on the conception of happiness. That's basically a conversation about that. What is the good life according to the Judaic tradition? And the book covers from the Bible to 17th century. I don't have an answer to you except to say that however you answer that question, you have to give a moral answer. You have to frame the questions in ethical terminology. We'll have to talk more about what will be part of the answer, but you cannot think about that question without thinking ethically and morally. Fair enough? And then about education, yeah, I agree that we need to turn that into, here's my answer to you as an educator. I would like to turn that kind of question to the center of what the educational program is about. It's not just about information. We are now calling ourselves, we are in the age of information. That to me is a catastrophe. Because information alone means nothing. It means something when you turn it into a worldview. What we need to do is to create new worldview. I think that the ecological worldview, let's call it integral ecology, that's a worldview that I would endorse. We need to think more in terms of integral ecology, and we need to think about the human good within that context. In my understanding of the human good, you cannot harm animals as part of being a good person. It's impossible. It's a contradiction in terms. So how to make the two work together, that's the challenge. Would there be one answer? No, there's not going to be one answer, but at least we will know how to think about the question, and that, I think, is the purpose of this lecture series, how to think about the question, not so much what to do tomorrow.
So, I also think that as an anthropologist, it's a that dichotomy is so false, right? I mean, we could also go culture-nature. Right? If you're talking as anthropomorphic as culture and biocentric as nature, that means nothing, right? So we don't live separate from the biosphere, and the biosphere doesn't exist separate for us. But in Islam specifically, it's very clear in the Quran that that God speaks to mountains, right? God speaks to animals. I mean, and one of the basic signs, if you think about the warning of the final day of judgment, what happens, nature is undone, goes totally unhinged. Humans aren't mentioned. We know that there are some stories about what will happen to humans, but the first, the calamity is a natural calamity where humans are part of that calamity, right? And so I, as an anthropologist, I see And in old anthropology, they used to bridge between culture and nature, right? There are all these Levi-Strauss and all these people who, and what does that mean, right? I mean, I don't know how I, as a human, can bridge between culture and nature. I'm human. The minute I start bridging, then there's a contradiction there, because how am I bridging as a human something I don't understand and I don't belong to? So I also think it's a dichotomy, that a duality that makes no sense.
Thank you very much. Gut, ich möchte ganz am Ende zwei Begriffe aufgreifen, die Frau Dr. Ammar in ihrem Vortrag verwendet hat, nämlich diese Dichotomie von Ackeln und Nackel. Und das eine ist sozusagen Nackel als die überlieferte Tradition der Religion und Ackel als die Ratio, der denkende Mensch. Und es ist sehr interessant, dass das Wort Akl vom im Arabischen von einer Bedeutung herkommt, des Festbindens, des Sich-Zügelns, des sozusagen der Hemmungslosigkeit, dem hemmungslosen Konsum entgegensteht. Und das, was ich von dem Abend, ich habe viele Dinge mitgenommen, aber so ganz zentral war sozusagen einerseits, wie viel wir in diesem Bereich aus den religiösen Traditionen lernen können. Also welche Schätze sozusagen in den religiösen Traditionen, in den Büchern versteckt sind und noch gehoben werden müssen, das ist eine Sache. Und der zweite Teil, Akel, die Ratio, das Denken, obwohl ich als Fußnote mit der Mortesile-Frage nicht ganz einverstanden bin, aber das ist eine andere Sache, aber diese Rolle der Ratio, des Denkens, des Sich-Zügelns, dass wir lernen müssen, auf intellektueller Ebene diesen Diskurs auf eine höhere Ebene zu bringen, auf eine bessere Ebene zu bringen, uns anzustrengen, dass sozusagen diese Werte tatsächlich auch in dieser modernen Welt und im 21. Jahrhundert kraftvoll werden, Macht bekommen, positive Macht bekommen. Und ich danke Ihnen beiden sehr herzlich für die wunderbaren Vorträge und dem ganzen Publikum für Ihre Geduld und für Ihre Aufmerksamkeit. Dankeschön. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.